Hey folks, welcome to another Triple T Thursday. For those just joining us, that's Tools, Tips, and Talk, where we'll discuss info for the knife maker. Yet again, today we're going to continue our intermediate series. This time, we're going to be grinding, heat treating, and doing all of the final grinding. So let's go down to the table and take a look. Okay, we're ready for the next step here. So the very first thing I want to do is fix up this tang. And one of the things that I didn't mention last time is that I actually forgot is, yeah, there's going to be a guard here. So the guard is usually 3/8 thick. So where your handle is going to start is actually about here. So I can just bring this down a little bit, and by the time it's here, I'll have the distance that I need. So we do need to file the edges nice and flat and even. Next we're going to do is the false edge, so we're going to just mark that with a scribe and then do the edge. So let's get going on those operations. So we're going to put our file guide here so that we can file in these shoulders. You can get these anywhere. This one I got from Jantz. This one doesn't have carbide things on it, so when you file it, it'll actually mar this. I don't typically use this for filing. I know it's a file guide, but I use it to lock things in the vise, or sorry, in the mill, because I have a mill. So if you're going to do a lot of filing, it's best to get one that has carbide here, so that on this side, so that you're not going to mark this up. For this, it's fine. It's not going to bother me. So for your guard, so this is all about where the guard is going to be. So now you need to decide, do you want your guard straight on with the blade? Do you want it at an angle? For this one, I tend to put my guards pretty even with the knife, kind of there. So what you're going to do is figure out exactly where you want it, and then lock in your file guide, and then you're going to file these. Okay, so let's lock that in. So I've got the file guide locked in the vise, all set up here. Now I'm going to take a file, and with this you got to make sure that the file is level with the file guide. So sometimes I like to just literally hold my finger on this as you're doing it, and take it slow. So I like to do the flat side and use the edge. If you have a file, the best way to do this is to get a file with no teeth on this side, that only has teeth on the edge, and then you can just do this. I always do the sides here because you can always take these down after. So come in from the sides and that'll get these nice and even. And just like in machining, do not take this reference off until you're sure you've got it really flat. The reason we're doing this is because we want this surface and this surface to be on the exact same plane, because that's what's going to meet on top of your guard. And if these two are off, or one's canted at a different angle than this one, when you put your guard on, you're going to see a gap. I think I've got it now. I have a little more to do on the tang, but I can do that after, just on the grinder, just to flatten this out a little bit. All right, we finished our tang here, straightened it out here. Drop this. You notice there's a little flat spot here and flat spot here. That's where the guard will sit. And then it drops a bit here, and then I have a little area left over for the handle here, because the handle is going to kind of come up to here and then start to go down. So looks good. Next, let's put the false edge in. So next thing you're going to need is layout fluid. And really, this should be part of the beginner series, and I think it is, but this is essential. Don't try to do this with Sharpies. Just get yourself some layout fluid. I'm going to just go and do both edges right now. The nice part about the layout fluid is it does not come off. in water. All right, because layout lines are key. Without lines, you're just grinding in the dark. So I got this little scribe on eBay. I love this one because you can just set it, sit it on here. Also, I have a granite surface plate. You don't need a surface plate. Just go get yourself a tile from any big box store. You can get a big tile for like $4. So go do that or get yourself a surface plate. You need something that's flat. Then I'll mark this, flip it over, mark it again. You don't need to have this one perfectly in the center, but it's easier if you do. Okay, so I've got both my scribe lines. I personally like, some people like kind of the double line. I kind of just prefer one line in the center. All right, so let's go grind this bevel. Okay, so let's talk about grinding the false edge. So yes, I have this set up in horizontal mode and I have a tilt rest. If you don't have these two, like if you don't have a large wheel, then you can do this with the 2-inch platen. Okay, it's just a little more difficult. If you don't have a tilting rest, what you do is put your flat rest on there and just build a bevel jig so that you're actually doing this. Or if your platen tilts. So one of those methods. So you have to combine those two. If you don't have a grinder that goes horizontal, then you're going to be doing it like this against the rest with the rest vertical. So you'll have to play around with it. Obviously, it's easier this way because you can see it, but it's certainly possible the other way. Okay, so let's grind this. So I've marked my center line. I've got my rest at an angle. I don't even know what angle. I don't care, really. I just want the angle on the same side. For false edges, you want this at least at about 60 degrees. I think I have it at closer to 70 degrees. And then we're just going to start at one end and just go down like that.
I always recommend you do the false edge before you grind your bevels. The knife will be nice and flat at this point, and it's easy to slide against the rest. Another important reason to do the false edge first is now you're grinding something that's completely even all the way down the blade. If you put your primary bevel in first, that means your false edge is going to taper, and that's much harder to do.
I wanted to take a minute just to talk about our sponsor, Maritime Knife Supply. And just look at the steel order that I got in last week's episode. So I wanted to show you guys. So the steel coming from Maritime Knife Supply is super flat. You'll notice that, and maybe you can see it in the camera or not, but it is cut, especially the 1084, it is cut. It is not hot rolled. So it is perfectly flat, which if you do Damascus is pretty important. I'm gonna show you the steel I typically use. Okay, I'm not gonna show you the maker and badmouth that, but you'll see that this is hot rolled and it is not very flat. I'm not sure it's coming up on the camera, but it bevels here. It's actually rounded here because of the way it's rolled. I actually ground this piece. And you see the edges here are not ground. And I really just touched this on the grinder for a second or two. So I end up having to take down the steel to get these areas out. So that's no fun. So really impressed with the steel from Maritime Knife Supply. So if you're a knife maker, go get it. Okay, we've got everything marked out. We're ready to grind our bevels. So go back to the tips on grinding from the beginner series. I'm not going to start at the beginning, but I'm going to use the rest. Just don't start at the very edge. Just work your way into it. So I have a nice sharp belt on here, and I'm going to start slowly, put the bevel in at the front, and then work my way up. That's where I want it. No higher, so I might go about 1/8 of an inch lower than that because this is just the pre-heat treat grind. And remember, I want to take this so that My false edge tapers to the very point, so it should disappear as I get to the point. Okay, I've marked off here so I know where my plunge is going to be. I'm going to hang the belt off because I want this rounded edge here. I'm going to hang the belt off at least the width of my stock. That's usually what I do, maybe a little wider. So this is pretty thin, just over an eighth, so I'm probably going to hang it off about a 16th, and that'll give me a nice arc there. And also will make your plunges not quite so sharp.
Grinding with this method is pretty easy, because you always have a point of contact, meaning the rest, so you're only dealing with dragging the knife left and right. Notice my thumb and the thumb placement, okay? That's where I'm pushing, and that's where the grind is going to happen. So the higher up my thumb is, the more towards the edge the bevel is going to be. When I want to move the bevel up the blade, then I'll move my thumb down. Of course, because the edge is up, I'll move my thumb down on the blade. Now I'm switching over to the other side. Everyone says they have problems grinding with their off hand. I'm no different. But with practice, you'll get them the same.
So here it is after grinding. This is just the initial grind preheat treat. So, I mean, it's a little wavy, but we'll fix that after. You can see I'm still away from my line here. And then on this side as well. But we've got the plunge lines the same. And the important thing is that it's even and it's perfectly centered. So hopefully we won't get any warps. So I was about to get ready to heat treat this and realized I totally forgot to do something. So I'm so used to doing guards, slotting guards with the mill, that I forgot that when we're doing this by hand with the file guide, you need to file a step right here. So you need to file all the way around. So I put the file guide back on just a little lower. So I filed this, and then put a little step here on both sides. So now I can measure the tang here, set my hole in my tang, I'll file the hole to fit this, and then this will sit on top, and then we're gonna hammer it on just to make sure there's zero gap. So I'll show you guys how to do that, but the step is definitely important. Because we're gonna be hand filing it, we won't get it perfect, so we need a little step. And then you just taper the tang and make sure that there's a slight, ever so slight taper from here to here. All right, we are ready to do some heat treating.
We're going to start by normalizing the steel. Since we've done a bunch of forging on it, we want it to relax. So I'm heating up the forge right now, and then we're going to put in the steel and get it up past magnetic and give it a couple more minutes to give it a nice orangey color. You'll notice I've got the forge turned way down. I want to be able to hold this knife in here at this temp and give it a good soak. You also see that I put it in tang first. That's because there's more mass in the tang than there is the tip. If you put it in tip first, you're going to overheat the tip. I use a magnet here to check the temp. Remember, it'll lose its magnetism at 1425. Then you're going to go a little past that, all the way up to around 1600 for this normalization. At the end, I just clamp it by the tang and let it hang to cool. I did a round of grain refinement after this normalization. I took it just past non-magnetic and then let it cool. But here I'm getting ready for the final quench. I'm checking its temperature, and when it's ready, I'll make sure the heat is nice and even, and then we're gonna quench. Remember, this is 10 series steel, 1095 and 15N20, which is really just 1080 with nickel. Those require fast quenching oil, so here I'm using Parks 50. Remember, you gotta leave it in the oil for at least 10 seconds, preferably 30.
I wanted to pause here and do a little mail call. So I got this from one of my Patreon members, Robert Venable, Bob. And I'm going to open this and show you guys this, because it may be something we have to use on this build. So I know you're thinking, wow, he sent you some ball peen hammers. Not quite. What these are is these are special hammers for taking out warps. So what Bob's done here is taken just a regular hammer, but put a carbide insert into the peen. And the theory here is that if you have a blade, I'll use this ruler as an example, that say is warped like this. Okay, we're going to accentuate that. The theory then is after heat treat and temper, okay, you can just take this hammer. I believe it would be on the concave side, and you can just keep tapping it, well, hitting it, okay, after temper, and because this is a carbide insert, it's actually going to imprint on the steel, and it'll be making little micro dents in the steel, and it will expand it and actually take the warp out. So I've never tried these before, but I've heard good things about them. So thank you, Robert. I am going to give these a shot. Luckily, on this build, the knife came out straight, but you never know. I might need them in the future. Thanks, Bob. So I quenched the blade and I put it between aluminum plates. If you don't have aluminum plates, that's fine. Put it between two pieces of steel. It's perfectly straight, so that's great. And this is a 65 HRC file, so it is skating like glass, so it's super hard. So now we're going to go into the oven at 400, sorry, not 450, at 400, and we'll temper it, and then we'll do the final grinding.
When I'm grinding a knife like this, I always start with the flats. Get those nice and flat, and then move on to your bevels. Here I've got one of Broadbeck's 120 grit ceramic belts, and that's what I'm going to do the final grind on the bevels with. This is where a variable speed drive on your grinder is critical. I've slowed this down to about 40% and take it nice and slow. I pay special attention to the plunge lines, making sure those are symmetrical and the height of the bevel is the same on both sides.
Here it is after final grinding. Looks pretty good. It went a little high right here, but I'll take that out in the hand sanding. Let's check our edge. So about 25, 26 thousandths on the edge. Yeah, about that. So that's pretty good. You wouldn't want to go much thicker than that for this kind of knife. It's got a nice tall grind, so it should be pretty slicey. We're going to wrap it up here this week with all the grinding finished, and I'll do some hand sanding and get prepped for next week. Next week, we're going to start talking about the guard. And for the guard, we're going to be using brass. And I'll talk a bit more about why brass in the next episode. Also, for the handle material, we're going to be cutting a piece of this beautiful maple burl block that one of my Patreon members, Kevin Sprouse, gave me at Blade Show. So excited about that. We're going to cut a slice of this off and use that. I think it'll look really good with the brass. So thanks for checking out this video, folks. We'll see you on the next one.